activities before May of 42 for the Coral Sea. And one of the things that I thought was quite interesting in your writing was the issue of the T-bone steak auction. Can you kind of tell me about that and what led up to it, and why was this the steak such a big deal?
Well, you know, when you get to sea so long, you'd do anything for a little fun to break the monotony. And what happened was, we'd been to sea so long, we were running out of food. There was one steak left on the ship. And so then they got together, the chaplain, the command, got together and decided that, well, we'll have a big deal, we'll auction the steak off. And so they had a big auction on the flight deck. Now we're at sea, and they parade the steak around with the ship's cooks, and the band plays as it's marching around, and the Marines are guarding the steak. And so a couple of fellows won the steak, and then the chefs had to, the cooks had to cook it for them like they wanted it, and it's just a lot of fun, really, and another day at sea and a little fun. Yeah, a smoker aboard ship is an entertainment. In other words, after you go so long, you'll get together and plan a night, and scaffolding will be rigged for staging, and there may be a boxing match, there may be a wrestling match, there may be other types of entertainment performed, vocals maybe, or whatever. And we had two men on there who were jitterbug artists, and they always like to see these guys jitterbug. And a smoker, that's what they call a smoker. In other words, time out, go have fun, go to the entertainment, and that's what they call it.
Yeah, a little break from the hard work.
A little break.
Yeah. Tell me what happened, first part of March and April, getting into May, and something that happened when you collided with an oiler just before the Coral Sea. And try what an oiler is and how a ship refuels.
Yes, what they do is, a carrier or a ship can go so long, then it has to refuel with bunker oil. And so it's time to refuel, and I think the Kaskaskia came alongside and to deliver fuel to Yorktown. And Gerald Vaughan, who later became the admiral, was the executive officer. And the Kaskaskia came alongside and bumped Yorktown. Now, when I say bumped, that doesn't sound bad, but it is bad. When you have two large ships with that weight, when they bump, it broke several ribs of the ship in the Yorktown, in the pipe shop area. And Gerald Vaughan danced a jig on the bridge, and he told the skipper of the Kaskaskia, "Move that thing or I'll sink it on the spot." But that was the incident there. Refueling at sea is a dangerous operation. I'll never forget on one occasion later when I was in the Navy as a chaplain, I was in destroyers. I was in the old Sutherland. And a tanker came alongside to deliver fuel to the destroyer, an oiler. That's what you call an oiler. I was down in the wardroom just reading. I had nothing to do, so I was reading. Finally, I hear the word pass, stand by for collision. Now, that alerts everybody. Collision, up to the top side I go. And here's this tanker right alongside the destroyer, and the destroyer can't get away because of tide elements and wind and things like this. And quite frankly, I prayed for the captain, I prayed for the ship, privately. And the funny thing came out of this. Finally, the destroyer began to move away from the oiler, and we got distance and separated. When we got back to Subic Bay, we all go to the club, you know, and so I'm generally loud, and so I saw the captain of that destroyer that I'm on, and he's talking to some person whom I didn't know. And I went up to the captain, and I said, "Well, Captain, I prayed you off the Kaskaskia today, didn't I?" He said, "Chaplain, meet the commanding officer of the Kaskaskia." I thought, yeah, I'll be a loud mouth. A lot of fun.
And you made it.
Yeah.
One of the things that when the ship is involved at, but it's a little bit of damage at that point, and we're still on
Yes, the two of us were there, Lexington and Yorktown, with our task force. And when the battle took place, we were all attacked at the same time. However, Lexington, being a heavier ship, built on the hull of a battle cruiser, did not have the turning radius that Yorktown had. And so Lexington took two torpedoes and two bombs simultaneously. No ship can hardly take that. And Lexington was afire from stem to stern. In fact, from the decks of the Yorktown, we watched the Lexington burn. One big ball of smoke, and our guys are in there, you know. And they would think that they would get the fires under control, but broken aviation fuel lines kept feeding the flames. So explosion after explosion after explosion. And finally, the commanding officer began to see that he couldn't save his ship. And that's when he ordered abandon ship, and we watched them come over the side, and of course, Lexington sank that day. In fact, we sank the Lexington to put out the fire. It was getting to be nighttime. That would be a big fire, a big target, and we could not get distance in the Yorktown. We'd be part of the target area. And so he ordered USS Phelps to fire and sink the carrier, the Lexington, the carrier. But we need to remind everybody that nobody alive went down with that ship. They were all gotten off. And but we lost the ship that day. Someone has said, and I think rightly so, numerically we lost, but strategically we won, because for the first time the Japanese forces had been stopped and did not accomplish their objective. Photographer on the Lexington, and he had been in an explosion. In fact, he'd gone down to get film for his camera. He was filming the battle on the deck, flight deck of Lexington, for the ship and for the Navy, and he went down to his lab to get more film. And while there, the ship received one of its bomb hits, which burst a high-pressure steam line in his compartment. Now, you're talking about 600 pounds live steam. And actually blew the shirt off his back and horribly scalded his face and neck and shoulders. And, of course, the doctor put tannic acid on it to try to heal the pain of it, and the best he could. And then when they finally saw they were going to lose the ship, he had to go over the side. I found out about this story from his sister. I was in a meeting in a church and met her. I didn't know the story at the moment. She told me about her brother in the Lexington. And I said to her, "Is he still alive?" "Yes." She told me where he was. Well, I decided I wanted to tell the story, but I needed to see him to get the first-hand account. And I did. I located him and made phone conversation. He said he'd be glad to talk to me. And the story was, he had been injured and in the bomb explosion with high steam and high pressure steam. Then when they saw they couldn't save the ship, they had to go over the side. I said, "Where did you go over the side?" He said, "I went over the side about midships down the lines into the water." He said, "When I got in that salt water," he said, "oh God, did that hurt my burns and my wounds." Now the sailor's in the water, the ship is sinking, and he's so worn out and tired and sick, and you can't swim in that stuff. He told me, "I finally decided to give up and go down with the ship." He made that decision. And having decided that, now This sister of his was a very godly old lady. I knew her before she died. A woman of great prayer. And she prayed for him. And when he made the decision to give up and quit and go down, another boat came alongside and threw him a line and pulled him away from the sinking ship. Now that's divine providence any way you look at it. That's why I named my book, God Was at Midway. Things like this.
You're able to verify that it was the same time that his sister was in deep prayer. Now,
yes.
You mentioned that what prompted her prayer. And what was...
Now, this is an amazing thing. Nothing prompted her prayer. In our church, we believe in praying in the Spirit. That is, when you groan before God, really in burden for prayer, you may not say anything, just simply burdened and groaning in prayer. The book of Romans talks about this. And in our church, we practice this. So she did not know she was praying for her brother. But it turned out she was. And they corroborated and verified that later. At that time, this guy's delivered and is saved from the sinking situation.
He said he was just about ready to give up when the line showed up.
When the line was thrown.
And I thought that was kind of very interesting that you were able to corroborate that.
Yes, and he says, I'll tell you the rest of the story. I said, please do. Well, the ship, that boat took him over to the mothership and take him aboard. And so the doctor says, he goes, take him up to the sick bay. The doctor says, all right, lie down. So he laid down. And he says, I don't remember the doctor giving me a sedative. All I remember seeing was he picked up the scalpel and began to peel the burnt flesh off of my face, neck, and shoulders. He says, God, did it hurt and did I bleed all over? Then at that time they had some new medicine. Of course, the common name, they call it green-blue spray or something. And then the doctor sprayed him with that stuff, and this man has not got a scar on his body. That's miraculous. I says, I suppose you're a churchman. He says, you better believe. But he's a retired contractor over in Laguna Beach today. But to me, these things don't just happen. I believe in divine providence. I believe in destiny. And
Henry Johnson.
Yes, Henry Johnson. That's right. Mm-hmm. Coral Sea was in May 8th. Midway took place June 4th, one month later. And Nimitz, knowing Midway was coming up, and that's an interesting story in itself, how he knew this. And he immediately called us back from the Coral Sea to get repairs, whatever we had, because he had to have us. And when we went into Pearl Harbor, Admiral Nimitz himself came aboard to see the ship and examine it. And Captain Buckmaster asked him for a six-month overhaul period. The Admiral says, I'll give you 72 hours. And you know, Roy, I generally say, you don't have committee meetings in the Navy. One man decides it. And so he immediately went into dry dock, and 72 hours we came out. Oh, yes, 24 hours a day. Welders. We'll have to say the yard workers at Pearl were great. They came aboard like ants swarming over that thing. Welders, painters, whatever. They did not have blueprints. Their command was, whatever is broke, fix it. No blueprint, just fix it. Generally, in that time, the band plays on the pier while the people work. the music as they work.
And what happened then?
That's what we did there. Then, in 72 hours, we left. And, of course, the problem was, now the story of the HIPO unit, Commander Rochefort in the HIPO unit, the Combat Intelligence Unit, very capable commander, and had studied in Japan, knew the language perfectly, and he's in this unit now, and he felt like that the codes, the messages they were picking up from the Japanese fleet, he felt like it was intended for Midway, but he couldn't prove it. And so he asked Admiral Nimitz, he says, why did you send a message to Midway? Now, Nimitz could send a message to Midway on a landline, which they could not pick up. So he sent a message to Midway for them to go out with an open message, open text, get the message out, you're short of water. And the Japanese bid on that one, and when they come out in their messages, their codes all express it's Midway. And so now we know what's going to happen and where it's going to be. And so then we're so short of ships, you got to send everything we got out there. And that's why we had to go make that trip. And out to Midway we go.
Now, this is one of the things that I thought when you mentioned at Stanford, Brian, the same time you were. And I thought that was kind of an interesting thing when you were saying how God was in Midway. And it was kind of an interesting thing that you were able to also develop some parallels. Could you kind of talk about that?
How is this now, Roy? Yes. Going up to Midway. Now, we had come out of the Coral Sea. Our first encounter, we had received one bomb hit that gutted 30 compartments, killed 56 men, and left the rest of us shaken. First experience we've had. And now, going up to Midway, we have a sense it's going to be worse than Coral Sea, because the HIPO unit had already picked up the fact that the Japanese fleet is coming against us at Midway with 185 ships. We're going with 33 ships. Now they have four fleet carriers. We have three, but one, Yorktown, is already injured. Those are the odds. Yet, you gotta go. I mean, you can't escape this one. And so, on the way up to Midway, one night, I actually got so, what term shall I use, depressed, I guess. In fact, I wondered if I would be in a debilitated state. Can I carry out my job? I got so wrapped up in this thing. And one night on the way up to Midway, I've been used to prayer. I prayed definitely. I said, God, if this is the time that I'm going to go, that's what you decide. But only one thing I do ask is that you take this fear out of my heart and my mind, that I can do the job I'm supposed to do. Now, I'm not particularly psychic or given to unearthly experiences, but I will have to say, physically, I felt the load lift off of my body. It is so surreal, I could hardly believe it. And the days would come, I would see what would happen to a ship, and we would give up a ship and go over the side. But I'll have to say, I had no fear. I walked through the whole thing. Now, I was not promised I would live through it, but the fear was taken away that I could exist through it. To me, that's miraculous. No counseling, nothing, just an answer to prayer, you know. I was in the Naval Academy two or three years ago now, and I had an interview with Admiral John T. Ryan, the superintendent. And Ryan says to me, he says, you ever been afraid? I says, yes, sir, I've been afraid. And I told him the story. And finally I said, Admiral, I'm going to tell you something else. Any man who says he's never been afraid is either a complete idiot or he's never faced reality. The old Admiral says, yeah, I think you're right. But That was the only difficulty I had, and but through the battle, I had no problem whatsoever, and handled my job well.
Oh, God, we put you again.
God was at Midway again, yes.
Now, what happened? Now, Yorktown was involved strategically in the Battle of Midway.
Yes.
Now, you were strategically moving there after 72 hours. Your ship was still leaking oil. Tell me about the ship's damages, even though they'd worked feverishly on it to patch it up.
Yes. We were under pressure to get out because they knew when the Japanese were going to strike, when the thing was going to happen. You talk about God being at Midway again, to have knowledge of the enemy's entire plans. That's unheard of. But we had it. And I might say something here, to show you something. At sea, or in the Navy, there's two philosophies of where you're going to locate the flag or the command. One is you take the flag, and when we say flag, we mean the admiral. Some believe in taking the flag to sea. That's what Japan did. Yamamoto in the great battleship Yamato, 18-inch naval guns, rifles. Our philosophy was leave the flag, Admiral Nimitz, leave him ashore. Okay, everybody knows where Nimitz is. You can't sink him, and he's free to use all communications. Yamamoto had to maintain radio silence in the ship, or they'd find him. So he was hurt. And so we're going up to that, and that engagement took place. And of course, an amazing thing, Nimitz told us, in fact, he gave a board and told us, Yorktown was not to be engaged unless necessary. Of course, you leave the whole pipeline open now. Well, it would have worked that way, except... Now, the amazing thing, you want to go into the battle here? The amazing thing is, when the thing came off, they sent an attack. They had four carriers down there. And, frankly, they were one of the finest navies in the world, if not the finest, and certainly outnumbered us. And they attacked Midway. The plan was to take Midway and then work on the islands on down. Midway is the northernmost part of the Hawaiian chain. It's part of the Hawaiian Islands. Take Midway, then go on down to Honolulu, Pearl Harbor. And so that's what we're going to defend. And so we go up there. And now, thank God for men like Nimitz, Spruance, and Fletcher. In other words, you've got to have brains now. You don't work your fleet against that fleet. So the plan is send the fleet about 150 miles northeast of Midway. And then when the Japanese fleet comes in, you attack the Japanese fleet. And the amazing thing is, that's exactly the way it worked. They did not even know we were at Midway. Part of the Japanese fleet thought we were still down in the Coral Sea. They hadn't heard we'd left. They had no idea we were there. And some thought we were still in Pearl Harbor. They made some critical mistakes that cost them. And in the warfare, it's not always who's the brightest, it's who makes the least mistakes. In the initial stages, it's all wonderment. I wonder what's going to happen. And you know that people are jockeying for position. Until finally, now, and incidentally, when you go to battle in these large ships, you lie on the deck. You don't stand up. Overheads are so short that you can break your neck on the overhead. The British had that experience and told us. So you lie on the deck. Of course, I've got the phones on. Things are moving on pretty good, and all of a sudden, over my headphones comes the word, enemy aircraft approaching 150 miles. Now, bear in mind, no jets at this time, all propeller-driven aircraft. Enemy aircraft approaching 125 miles. Enemy aircraft approaching 100 miles. It just keeps working on down. The thought comes to me, I wonder if this is real. And yet the guy's telling this is what's going to happen. And so finally he says, stand by for air attack. And kabloom. The bombs go off. If I remember correctly, we received seven near misses and three direct bomb hits, I think. And now we're dead in the water. And that is a crucial time. I mean, you're dead. If torpedoes come now, that's it. Now, in naval air... Yeah, temporarily.
What's the mind when all this starts to happen? What kind of feelings do you have?
Well, I tell you what, at the time, you don't really have feelings. You've been trained so much, this is just another training session. That this is what happens, you've been through this, you've actually had the feeling you've been through it before because of training.
When the second time, when you start into Yorktown, this is more than it was at Coral City.
Oh, yes. Well, because we knew the whole Japanese fleet was coming down. We knew that. And it's not a small fleet. They're going to throw the weight of the thing behind it. And this is a, from their viewpoint, you make it or you don't. From our viewpoint, you make it or you don't. I mean, this is crucial. Goes off or a shell's fired or something of that nature. But the thoughts that enter your mind are, as you lie on the deck, I wonder if this one's going to get me. What will it be like? What will it feel like? What's going to happen? I mean, you have time for this kind of stuff to run through your mind. I think most people would think this way, but it's not of a nature that would incapacitate one. But you do wonder what's going to happen, you know. And the bombers came first. Now, in naval air, the bombers and torpedo planes are supposed to come at the same time. The bombers from on top and the torpedoes from the side. The idea being you can't miss all of them. If you watch the bombers, the torpedoes get you. If you watch them, the bombers get you. But they were not coordinated to our benefit. So the bombers came, and we took three bomb hits, and I think seven near misses, if I remember. But it left us dead in the water. One bomb went right down the stack and snuffed the engines out. Well, now this is crucial. This will upset you. Because you're dead if torpedoes come now. But we had a very fine crew, engineering crew, who cross-connected their steam plants, get the steam in the right place with the boiler that would still work, and this kind of thing. And within an hour, had us underway again. However, we could not attain the speed we needed. In the Battle of the Coral Sea, we probably reached 32 or 34 knots. Here, when we got underway again, we could only do 15 knots. Not enough to miss torpedoes. And so then the torpedo planes came. Then we're going to try to stave them off. But two caught us out of the, I think probably 10 or 12 were fired. Two got us. Simultaneously, nearly the same hole midships. In fact, it was just forward of where I was, just several compartments. And when those two torpedoes struck, it felt like some great arm just lifted that carrier and dropped it. And when it dropped a 27-degree list. Lights went out. Smoke fills the compartment. You can't see anything, of course. You're on a 27-degree deck. What are you going to do now? And lying on the deck, broken water mains, water is now running over you as you lie on the decks. If you have claustrophobia, it'd be pretty tough. So what are you going to do now? Well, what happened was the commanding officer, got with his damage control officer and discussed the situation and felt like the ship might capsize. You know, all naval vessels have a certain degree they know what they can take before they will go on over. In fact, they got those gauges on the bulkheads, and they felt like the Yorktown might do that. So he orders to abandon ship. And so down there, now of course you have battle lanterns, but that's not much light. So you take your shoes off, and you crawl up the decks to get to the ladder, only to find that the ladder, the hatch, has been jammed by explosions. However, in the middle of every hatch is a scuttle that you can go up through, and that's what we were doing. Of course, this is going on throughout the ship. And so we make our way up. I'm on the third deck, to the second deck, then to the hangar deck. And I looked at the hangar deck. It looked like some great fingers just picked hunks of it up. Had been brutalized by the bombs. And so then we make our way to the top side. Now we put on the Kapok life jackets. They call them Mae West life jackets, the Kapok, you know, big, and put those on. And some of the sailors, being very neat, had neatly stacked their shoes on the side of the ship. That's like stacking the chairs on the Titanic before you go over. And the deck crews had hung 2-inch lines from the flight deck to the water, all down the side of the high side of the ship. And so those from the flight deck and the bridge came down to the flight deck and go down. We from below would come up to the hangar space, go to the high side, find a place on the line, and go down to the water.
The starboard side. Then he said abandon ship at that point. Now, the 1NC was still working. You were getting communications from 1NC. And we didn't discuss this till the end. I don't know the panic that goes into when somebody's abandoned ship that you're home. What went to your mind when the word came out to abandon ship? Tell me, how do you get the information?
Yeah, well, we get it over the phones and the 1MC. And, of course, the thought there is, if the old man's going to abandon ship, then we're worse off than we think. And, of course, now the plan is, okay, get off as quick as you can. And but I will say one thing, the crew was well trained. There was no panic. Nobody running amok anywhere. Everything moving in order as we've been trained. And So we get up to the high side to go down the lines, and of course there's oil in the water 6 to 8 inches thick. And here's another thing. Had there been a fire, we would have burned to death in the sea. There was no fire. There were no shark because explosions had scared all shark away. And so I tell people, and the nearest land was only 3 miles away, straight down. So down the side we go. And another thing, when you go over the side, you go over just in your skivvies, just in your underwear. No shoes, no hats, no clothing, just your underwear. And when we got in that oily water, we had oil in our eyes and our ears and our nose. Some got it in their mouths and vomited. And you could hardly recognize anybody you knew in all that sort of stuff. And so getting down into the water. And then another thing, there's always a surging sea, generally. And the water will come up and the water will go down, up and down. Well, what you do is, when you're hanging on the line, you hold on till the water comes up to where you are. Then you let go and go down to the water. If you let go while the water's down, then you may be buried 30 feet under until that life jacket pulls you back up. And so down to the water we went. And we were in the water probably about 4 hours or so. And the way they rescued us was, our own destroyers were there. They would very slowly come up into a group. just before I went over the side, I took one look out, and there's 2,500 heads out there bobbing in the sea, and I'm going to join them. But these destroyers would come up very slowly into a group of people so as not to churn them up, drop cargo nets over the side, and then as the sea would wash you up against one of these ships, you'd hang on the cargo net, and they would pull you over. And I thought, well, that's not too bad an idea. So I was washed up alongside the destroyer USS Balch. And I thought, well, I get on the cargo net, just climb on over. Not so. It's amazing how the sea can enervate you, take all your energy. It was all I could do to hold on. I didn't realize how tired I was. Of course, they had men there to pull you on over the ship, over onto the ship. And like I say, I used to smoke in those days, and they wanted to give everybody a package of cigarettes and come on the side. Here, mate, take this. I said, I don't need that. So when they pulled me over, now amazingly, these destroyers had a crew of probably 225 people. But each destroyer was picking up 500 and 600 men out of the sea. Think what a crowd we had on board. And but when I got aboard this destroyer, 6 or 7 men out of my Bible class recognized me. And one guy yells, there's the deacon. And about 6 or 7 of us walked to the stern end of that destroyer and knelt down and had an open-air prayer meeting. And nobody was embarrassed. And that's the way that one wound up. Starboard side.
Starboard side, from the tower. That's quite a ways now. Did the lines go all the way to the water?
No, not quite.
How far did you have to drop?
Well, on the level deck, it would be about 80 feet to the water. Of course, you had a 27-degree list. I don't know what distance that made that. But you could the lines go down to, I would guess, about 20 feet of the water, something like that, if, as I remember. Then you wait till the water comes up and go with it. And
mm-hmm. So everybody's getting picked up at that point. Now, you transferred a couple of ships now.
Yeah.
And you transferred by Highline from one ship to another. The Balch, you went from...
To the USS Portland.
And that's a cruiser.
Yes.
How did you get from the Portland to the cruiser?
Highline.
Now, same as there were, 400 tons.
Yeah.
600 tons.
Yeah. But they took us, this overloads the destroyer. So they moved us to the Portland, because they can handle more people, feeding and letting it. But let me say this. The crews of these ships are something else. They're, among military personnel, there's a camaraderie that I don't think many civilians recognize. Because you're in the same boat. I mean, you're all in one fraternity, really. And these men on these ships would get into their luggage. Now, remember, we had nothing. They would give us shoes. They would, their own personal shoes, extra shoes, shirts, trousers, out of their own luggage, and they're not being reimbursed for this. These are did it to help us to get dressed. Great feeling. Yeah, we didn't go below on these ships.
Yeah, what would you say there's no, when you went for the Balch, and then you went, how would you, your prayers, you kind of used in occurrence, that nobody was embarrassed of. Well, what did it do for those who were praying?
Big pardon?
What did prayer do for those who were praying?
Well, it gives a sort of confidence, idea of confidence, I think, reassurance. Believing there, if you want to use the term God or a higher power is watching over. You know, someone said of Admiral Spruance at Midway, at the end of the thing, and I like this, he had a sense of destiny, a calm sense of destiny, that he could remain cool under trying circumstances. I think that's what it does for you.
It provides a lot of perspective.
Yes.
When you were
the Yorktown would not have sunk. The captain took us off because he's afraid it might capsize. In fact, the Navy sent the tug, the ocean tug, Vireo out to tow it back to Pearl Harbor. But at 1 1/4 knot an hour. And of course, as most people now know, that the Japanese submarine I-168 got inside the radar screen and fired 4 torpedoes. One missed, 2 hit the Yorktown below the bilgekeel, and 1 hit the USS Hammond, which had come alongside to take off to supply water and electricity and take off records. It broke that little ship in 2, and nearly all hands went down. And then their own depth charges exploded and killed many in the water.
And from Hammond.
From Hammond, yeah.
And now that was the day after you were out of port. At that point, you didn't even know that.
No, we were off.
When did you get the news that the Yorktown had gone down?
I don't guess we got it until we got back to, they took us back to Pearl Harbor. Yeah, and then we were in the Salt Flats, Aia Heights, where actually they interned us. They wouldn't let us go into town. They're afraid we might say something, which we probably would. But in those days, it was so crucial that nobody leaked any information out. Whether the Japanese knew they sank the ship, I don't know, but you couldn't run the risk of telling it. We were so short of material.
So you guys were confined?
We were confined.
No liberty?
No liberty.
Now, how bad?
No, I was served at the Naval Air Station later.
And I thought you had moved over there.
No, we're from Aia. From Aia in Hawaii, we went from there back to Treasure Island. Yeah.
Now from TI.
Yeah,
and
TI.
You heard about the Yorktown going down at that point. And you got back to TI about a month later?
Mm-hmm, about a month later.
And what was going on? From June to September, 3 months later, we finally disclosed.
Yeah.
So you weren't able to talk about it?
No, we didn't have any information, really.
So no one really knew? Now, you were, at that point, still, you got back, you got all the oil off of you, you rehabilitated, you assigned a new unit. You got back to, yeah, what happened at that point?
Well, we were in Treasure Island for 2 months. And so then I brought Verna up to stay in a hotel for a part of the time, and we had liberty. But then later, well, after the 2 months, the band, most of us were together, was transferred to Miami, Florida, where we're going to tough out the rest of the war. So we're involved down there, mostly official situations and fundraisers and all that. And of course, the dance men played their regular jobs for the USO and things of that nature.
And was there ever any recognition for you guys from around the Yorktown?
No, and that is a sore point for some of us. The Yorktown took the brunt of that battle. The only ship to come under fire at Midway was the Yorktown. And we feel like the ship should be given a presidential unit citation.
And never was.
Several have pursued it. I pursued it in one case, only to be told that the statutes of limitations were over. We all know the statutes of limitations don't hold anymore. And then one responded to me was, well, no one asked for it at the time. No one was in position to ask for it. So that's one sore point we do have.
And so you continued from there, and you served
went back in the Navy.
And, well, no, I'm saying like 45, uh-huh. You were still in the Navy, but you've gone back and forth from D.C. for training.
Yeah.
And, but you haven't been in D.C. since 39.
Yeah.
How would you contrast?
Well, the younger men then, having no battle experience, really gave us the point. They may not have their head screwed on, and I don't use that loosely. They don't seem to realize where the real world is. It's still a fun Navy for them, but it no longer is a fun Navy for us. And in fact, I went out with a band, the second band I went out with, I was the master of arms for the band, that is, the guy who watches over the troops and so forth. And we thought they were either foolish or sometimes silly, and that doesn't mean they're not good men, it just means they're youngsters. And
you were changing, also you were still continuing your prayer. I mean, how would you describe how that changed? That also changed you.
Well, as time went on, I became, what happened was, I decided that I would get out and go in the ministry. However, frankly, even as an enlisted man, I loved the Navy. I liked the Navy. I had no fight with the Navy. And finally the thought came to me, if I could get my education and stay in the Navy, I'd have the best of both worlds. And so I went out of the Navy then in 1947, February, and went to college and seminary. I was out 8 years. Meanwhile, while I'm out, I build a church and pastor two or three others. And then I come back in the Navy, and I'm accepted, and I had the best of both worlds.
When you finished your education and seminary, you came back as a chaplain.
Mm-hmm.
And that was as an ensign or as a captain, as a lieutenant?
Lieutenant junior grade.
Lieutenant JG.
Yep.
And so you went through all of those promotions to become a captain. That took how long to take?
17 years, which was fast. No war on now, you know. But interesting, I was the first chaplain in the Navy from my church. And Admiral Salisbury was the chief of chaplains, and I kept in touch with the Navy because I'm trying to get in. I want to be aware of what's going on, you know. He had come out to Washington, and this had to be 1947, maybe. And I knew he was going to be in San Diego, so I made an appointment to see him. Now, Salisbury is a rough individual. He had been an enlisted Marine previously, World War I, I think. So my church is a charismatic church or a Pentecostal church. Generally, no one ever got an education, you know. But I wanted to be a chaplain. So I had an appointment with Admiral Salisbury. He says, "Linzey, come here." So I walked in. We talked to him, and he says, "What church do you belong to?" I said, "I belong to the Assemblies of God, chaplain." "Well," he says, "we need people like you. We're going to make room for you." Just like that. So I was the first from our church, and I was the first one to train the rank of captain in from our church in the military.
And you opened doors for many others.
Yes. Frankly, we had a very good reputation, and God helped us give them some of the greatest religious programs in the Navy. And it was my privilege to lead well over 5,000 men and women to a conversion experience to Jesus Christ.
Also, you opened the door for other ministers as chaplain, too.
Yes.
How would you, you mentored others?
Yes, I had a very interesting experience in the USS Coral Sea. I called these boys, three of them, they were enlisted men. I call them my three musketeers, three enlisted men, belonged to different churches, but made a profession of faith in the Coral Sea. And, well, in fact, these boys were Catholic lads, very fine boys. One fellow, the sharpest young man I ever met, went out, got an education, got married, came back into the Navy. One was an Assemblies of God chaplain. One was a Four Square gospel chaplain. Navy chaplain, Four Square Air Force chaplain. He's now a colonel serving down there in San Antonio, I think. And then one became an Army chaplain from the group in Dallas. These guys, I mean, these guys carry the message, you know.
And they were all in the Coral Sea.
Yep, all in the Coral Sea.
Now, that was a ship that had a peculiar history for you.
Yes, it does. And one of the greatest ministers of my career was in the Coral Sea. In fact, we had, in June the 1st, we was up at Marine Memorial Club in San Francisco for the 60th celebration of Midway. Chief of Naval Operations came out. But Admiral Paul Peck, retired in Oakland, at one time was commanding officer of the Coral Sea. Very fine man, churchman. When he heard I was coming up to the Marine Memorial Club, he emailed me. He says, "Come early. I want to talk. We got a lot to talk about." We just had a grand reunion.
Now, the USS Coral Sea, a new carrier, tell me about Coral Sea and your ministry on board that ship.
Well, I went aboard Coral Sea and had to be 68. 68 I went aboard Coral Sea. And I didn't do anything different than I did anywhere else. I mean, chaplains do certain things, you know, and... But it seemed like the men rallied to me in a great way. Until finally we were having all kinds of religious meetings and things. It was one of those things you didn't have to plan, you just had to keep up with, you know. And I had a fine group of men. Then I had lay leaders for the groups that were not part of my own faith. We do that. In other words, the Mormons will have a leader, but I'm responsible to see that they get their equipment or whatever they need. The Jewish lay leader, well, I can't lead that, but the lay leader will, and I'm responsible that he can do it. And just, in fact, ecumenism came about because of the Navy chaplaincies and the military chaplaincies. We learn to work together and respect each other.
You retired in what year?
I retired in 1974.
And 20 years more than that? 28 years.
I have 20 years as a chaplain, yeah, as an officer, yes.
And tell me about your family. You were married, and how many children did you have?
Well, Mrs. Linzey and I have 10 children, 5 boys and 5 girls. That's good planning. It worked out that way. Very fine family. Mrs. Linzey is a beautiful mother and took care of the kids while I'm gone, and they all got educated. College education, some, in fact, if I could boast a bit, all have been to college, 9 graduated, 7 masters, and 3 doctors. Yeah, they've done very well.
And now, you, one thing you didn't mention briefly, but both your wife and you and your family now have a whole pile of Linzeys. Can you talk about, now that, in other words, this is not often that a doctor spawns another doctor.
Well, I tell you, we brought the children up. They're always in church. There was never a question, are we going to church or not? That was understood, we're going to church, whether I'm preaching or not. And then when I'm gone, Mrs. Linzey kept them in church and Sunday school. She gets a lot of responsibility for that, or gets a lot of acclaim for that. But we've also brought them up to love the church. Now, you know, there's a lot of things going on in church that people don't like. You can get bitter if you're not careful. But we never let that happen. And the kids came up enjoying church. And right now I've got 4 boys who are ministers. One's the principal of a prestigious high school. And 2 or 3 of the girls married ministers. The rest are school teachers. They're all professional people. One boy is a technician at the Los Alamos National Laboratory. They've all done well, but we brought them up to read and to think. And we've always had books and magazines where they could.
And now you're celebrating your anniversary, in other words. Tell me about that.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's right. July 13th will be our 62nd anniversary. No, that's not right.
You were married in 41.
41? Married in 41?
61.
61. 61.
61, yeah.
60. 62? Yeah. And we're both in good health. God's blessed us. Yes, I will. On June the 1st in this year, they had a big 60th, of course, throughout the fleet, they're celebrating the 60th anniversary of the Battle of Midway. This is now a fleet-wide observance from now on forever. And this is the 60th anniversary. I was supposed to go out to Pearl Harbor again, but I'd been sick in December and decided not to go. I was supposed to go to the Naval Academy again, and I turned that one down. In fact, Admiral Hauser said, I hope you'll come next year. But then I found, some friend, Grist, Walter Grist maybe told me about them, San Francisco. So we decided to go up there, and I was a participant in that. But this medal, Admiral Vern Clark came out, and they presented the survivors with these medallions, Navy Department medallions, some of the finest I've seen. And that's what that's all about.
Now listen, how long did it take you to write your book?
Well, the way this book came about, I've been actively engaged in ministry since I retired. Literally been around the world. And wherever I'm invited, I go, you know. And I was telling some of these sea stories in the churches. And in one of our churches, one of the pastors is a very capable writer, the Reverend David Womack, and a personal friend of mine. We were out eating one night after the service, and he says to me, these stories you tell, are you going to write that up? I said, well, I don't know. He said, you probably won't do it. He said, I'll tell you what, if you'll rough it up, I'll edit it for you. I said, all right, I'll do that. And so the Reverend Womack is responsible for me getting it out into print like it is. And the book's done very well. In fact, we're in the Arizona Museum. I signed books out there a year ago. We're in the Naval Academy. We're in the Admiral Nimitz Museum. I'll tell you about the Admiral Nimitz Museum. I had been there, and they bought my book. Oh, it's been 3 or 4 years now, I guess. I got a letter from a lady in New Braunfels, Texas. She told me who she was. She says, Chaplain, I visited the Admiral Nimitz Museum, and I saw your book, and I immediately bought it and turned to chapter 5. That's the story of the Battle of the Coral Sea. She says, my father was a chief petty officer, and he was killed in that battle. Well, I mean, that was the guy that got, they all got blown over in front of us. She says, we didn't know how it happened till you told us. It just made me feel good that it was helpful to somebody. Find out what happened, you know. And we're just about out of our second edition and may go into a third. It's done very well.
You know, we officially have a chance to thank you on behalf of the California Military Museum and the California Military History Educational Fund. You and your wife have been tremendous. And reading your book, I've got some tremendous insights, but I wanted to thank you for coming to visit with you today. And officially, one of the things in your book that was, that was very important to me was discussing Commander Fushida. There's a Japanese officer whose name is quite well known, Japanese side during the Battle of Midway and through the climbing of Pearl Harbor. His name was Fushida. Could you tell me about him and the significance of him to you and your religious efforts?
Yes, Commander Fushida, you know, led the attack on Pearl Harbor. And he was the flight commander and did a very successful job. And then on through the war, when it came to the Battle of Midway, Fushida was sick in the sick bay in the carrier and could not fly and probably saved his life. But then there was an Air Force sergeant by the name of Jacob DeShazer, who during the war had been interned, shot down, while he was with Doolittle, and was downed in Japan, and interned. He wrote a tract on Christianity and Fuchida read it and got converted. And then Fuchida, after he got out of the Navy over there, he became a lecturer for Christianity in Japan and Asia and then in the United States. And an amazing thing, when I wrote my book, I wanted to find Fuchida to get the story, but he had died. And then I was directed to Jacob DeShazer, who is a retired old man now up in Salem, Oregon. Very godly old man and his wife. And we had a very wonderful visit with him, and he told me the story and what God did. And it's an amazing thing, out of those leaders, you know, Tojo was hung. Yamamoto was shot down over Bougainville. Fuchida lived to be converted and become a Christian and become an evangelist. Very interesting story how these things happen. Yes, of course, it was distasteful to the Japanese. The fact that he would leave Buddhism, which is a family religion, it's a national religion, and become a Christian, because of his status, they couldn't really do him in, because he's the guy that led the attack on Pearl Harbor, and but they didn't appreciate his conversion. That is true. And you know, after during the war, shortly after, I guess, when MacArthur became the emperor in Japan, he called the churches for 3,000 missionaries, and we didn't send him any. That may have been a different story if we'd sent missionaries over at that time. He realized the value of the missionary. But Fuchida was an evangelist in his own right and had great success among his own people, as well as here, of course. Talk about it is this. I have a son who recently retired from the Navy Chaplain Corps with a rank of captain. And it seems to be this. When I went into the Navy, it was a very colorful corps. Everybody, each individual chaplain, did what he thought he ought to do and did it. In the present day and age, it seems to me now that everybody is so afraid of his rank, so afraid of being attacked, that nobody does anything outstanding. In other words, it's part of this cultural relevance thing. Be smooth, don't make any ripples, we're all equal. Therefore, some of your best talent doesn't work today, like we did in our day when a guy would do whatever he could do. And I believe that's one of the biggest changes. We've calmed everything down where everybody wants to be equal. No one wants to take a chance anymore. In our day, if you saw something was wrong, you could even risk your career to try to right it. I ran into that on one occasion, which afterwards it sent shivers up down my spine. What had happened? I was in the USS Coral Sea, and I went. You know, the Navy, the chaplain has to visit the brig in the hospital every day, so I went down, and here's a Marine who's guarding a prisoner. And he wasn't hurting the prisoner, but he acted like he was going to hit him. And the young sailor was a very youngster. He was actually crying. So I said to the Marine, take the young man up to the sick bay for overnight safekeeping. Aye, sir. Then I called the sick bay from there, and I said, I'm sending a man up for overnight safekeeping. Okay, no problem. Now, I should have immediately informed the commanding officer. And I don't know today why I didn't even think of it. No reason. It must have been about a week later, I was in the executive officer's cabin talking with him, and I happened to think of this and told him. He nearly came unglued. He said, does the captain know this? I said, I don't think so. He left me sitting there and made it to the bridge to tell the captain. I thought, uh-oh, I wonder what's going to come out of this. Well, it must must have, of course, on those ships, you have, the chaplain has to go to the bridge three or four times a day to see the captain on something. And the next time I went up to the bridge, I'm thankful that I was calm and the captain was calm. And so in just general, of course, I was the same rank as the captain, and he could bear his soul to me, knowing it's not in the chain of command. He's not going to go anywhere. And he says, I understand you took a man out of the brig the other day. Now get this play on words. I understand you took a man out of the brig the other day. I says, no, sir, I did not. You didn't take a man out of the brig? No, sir, I didn't. I had the Marine take him out. That saved my soul. He said, you didn't do it. I said, no, sir. He says, you know that's my brig. I said, yes, sir. And I said, Captain, we suspect brutality in the brig. Sure enough, 2 days later, they had a couple of Marines on report for brutality. And, but that's a scary thing. And, but I did what I felt I should do. And I think if anybody's going to be worth his salt, he's got to have some principles that he works by, you know. Yet he's got to be sure he stays in the chain of command with things, with protocol, you know. That's the big thing. But I had visited earlier, before I was my rank, when I was a junior chaplain, a Methodist chaplain had taken a man out of the brig. And this story reminded me of that and gave me the impulse to do that. So it was not an unheard of thing, but it's a touchy thing.
So the chaplain's responsibilities and roles and authority has changed.
Well, if so, it's because he's let it. Some of us used to say, you use the cross when you can, otherwise you use the eagle.
For letting us do that. I really appreciate that. I've forgotten that question, and I wanted to ask that about Fushida. I think it's very important.
Yes, it is.
For those of us all served in Japan one time or another, and worked with Japanese officers at different time or another, and witnessed a very closed society. It's still closed.
Yep, yep.
Very different than other parts of the
world. Several people we've hurt that we should be helping who helped us at a critical time.
Well, because of that, we had a very good relationship. When he passed away, he died, cancer and other things, young man. Anyway, I pushed to give him a posthumous promotion. So I said, I want to do it personally. So I insisted it be sent to me. Upset a lot of people, but at his funeral I could present an award to him as Lieutenant Colonel.
Yeah, good.
So that's what we did.
Sure.
But the kind of things that because of these kind of things, we printed a lot of friends, and in fact, so much so the other day, I interviewed a gentleman who served in the Filipino. He assumed I was Filipino because I'm so close to the Filipino community. And I said, no, I'm not.
Yeah.
But there's an area where I made fast friends and at all different levels. And it's interesting how different societies in Asia are open.
Yep, yep.
I found that the Australians, of course, can't consider them Asians, but they're Asian. They're Indians.
Yep. Probably some of the last friends we have.
Mm-hmm. And the Taiwanese, even very that's how political words change.
Yep,
right?
Yep.
So when we have a lot of ground there. We're gonna, but I think the job as a chaplain is a very interesting job.
Mm-hmm.
And I would never have even known much about it having worked with several chaplains on several duty stations.
Yep,
and,
yep.
So then when I took different command issues, I wanted to make sure that the chaplains were included. Staff mates often thought they were never included.
Yep. Well, they are now.
Yeah.
Seniors are. Seniors
are.
Yeah, I know. We went out with Marines. I went out with Marines from Okinawa on a Marlex to Thailand, Salaheap Naval Base. When we get there, we go. Yeah, we go ashore to let the Thai Marines practice wet net landing. So, I'm new with Marines at this time. I didn't know.
Well,
those.
I get a picture of you three.
Oh, I need to get a picture.